victory. It is good to be in the house of the Lord another time where we can come and rejoice before the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and thanksgiving. Let your requests be made known unto God. We bless the Lord that we can be in His house today. Today we are picking up again where we left off last week. We started in the book of Matthew. We commenced the book of Matthew last week. And we are going to pick up from where we left off. I think we stopped there at verse 6 at the book of Matthew chapter 1. So we are going to bow heads in prayer as we go into the book. Gracious Father, Most High God, we thank you for this privilege that you have given us, that we can open up this new book that we are studying today. Lord, even as we open up with the genealogy of your son, Yeshua, we pray for the skills, the ability, the wisdom, the knowledge, and the understanding of God, so that we can deal with all of these different names that we are going to deal with in this genealogy. God, I pray that you reveal yourself. Let your son, Yeshua, be revealed to us. God, where this genealogy seems to be dry and there is nothing exciting within it, I pray that you'll excite the spirit of your people. Amen. Even as we open up this chapter today. We bless your name. We ask these favors in the name of your son, Yeshua. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. Now we are talking about the genealogy of our Lord Yeshua. And last week we saw where the genealogy started from Abraham, and it's going down to King David. And from David, it goes all the way back to Yeshua. And we are looking at this genealogy that a lot of people are saying that is very dry. And most people don't like to read this genealogy because they think that there is not a whole lot in this genealogy. But when we look at those verses that we dealt with last week, we saw some very eye-opening information came to light. And things that most theologians, they don't really want to talk about. And we saw that the genealogy started out with Abraham, and it runs down to David, because it must be that the Messiah must be connected to Abraham. He must be connected to David, because the Most High God promised David that there is a son that is coming who is going to sit on his throne, and this son is going to be the Son of God. It's going to be, he will be able to call God his Father, and God will call him his Son, and this person is going to rule forever. So we saw that the genealogy connect the ancestry of our Lord Yeshua to Abraham, to David, and that is where we are picking up today. And in this genealogy, we did also discover that there are four great-great-grandmothers that is spoken about in this genealogy. And we said last week that these four women that is mentioned in this genealogy, because it was not a custom. It was not a custom for people to put women in genealogy. So we saw where the Most High God find it fit to put these four women in this genealogy. And these women, we have Tamar, and we have Rahab, we have Ruth, and we have Bathsheba. And all of these women, according to the Bible, they were Canaanite women. They were not Hebrew Israelite people. And as we discussed last week, Canaanites in the Bible, when we talk about Canaanites and we are dealing with the Canaanites in the Bible, we are talking about the son, it was Ham's son, Canaan, the one who European theologians said that the Most High God placed a course on, and the course on Ham and Canaan caused all of his generation to become black and dark skinned. So when you talk here, I know this sounds uncomfortable to some people, but if we don't want to deal with this kind of thing, we have to cut that page out from the book of Matthew. Take it out and we don't deal with it. But because it's there, we're going to have to deal with it. So what we're talking about, when we talk about Canaan or Canaanites, we are talking about people from that line of Ham. And when you talk about Ham, you're talking about black, dark skin. And the people that we are talking about here, these four women, the four great-grandmothers of the Messiah, they were Canaanite women. And as we trace this genealogy, we can see that this genealogy, it is people from the line of Shem. We have people from the line of Shem, and we have these four women from the line of Ham. So what you can see here, if we are honest Bible student, this morning we say we are Bible student. We are all Bible students, and if you're a student of the Bible, you have to be honest. When you see tough things in the Bible, you can't throw it out. You have to deal with it. So these four women, they are from the line of Ham. And the genealogy is from Abraham, which Abraham is a descendant of Shem. And these four women are descendants of Ham. So in honesty, the genealogy that we are dealing with here in Matthew is a genealogy that is mixed with Shemites and Hamites. And according to what we are seeing, there is no person or persons from the line of Japheth that is mentioned in this genealogy. And when you look at this genealogy and you see these four Hamites or Canaanites women, you see that these people are in this genealogy, we are dealing with women who have their ancestry from Canaanite background, or you can say from African background, but I know a lot of people don't like to talk about these things. But even though we have these four great-great-grandmothers that have African background, they are from the line of Cain, which made them Hamites, still we end up having a white nation of Israel. Could you imagine that? We have all of these people in the genealogy here, these four African descent grandparents in the genealogy, and still we end up still having a white nation of Israel. And as we talked about last week, all Europeans, according to Genesis chapter 10, and according to what most honest Bible theologians and scholars will tell us, all Europeans are from the line of Japheth. And when you check today, there's 52 European countries. And all Europeans, doesn't matter where they're from, those in Australia, we know that those in Australia, they went there when the British were sending across their convicts over there. And that is how the white people over in Australia end up in Australia. We have those in the United States. Some of them went over there as convicts also. And some of them was also pilgrims. So some of them, they came over from England. So they came over from Europe. You have those from New Zealand. We have those from Pakistan, those from Canada. I'm talking about those from outside of Europe. They all from Europe. They all originate from Europe. But what the point I'm trying to say is that all European people or white people is from Europe. But then the church is telling us that there is an exception. There's only one group of European people originate in Canaan land, and that is the group that we call God's chosen people. And for me, it is just like what a senior hall used to say, things that make me go I have to scratch my head to see that all that whole race of people is from Europe, except that one white race of people that is living in the land of Canaan. They are from North Africa. And I say it doesn't add up. And if it doesn't fit, you have to throw it out. It doesn't fit. So I'm talking about seeing this genealogy and all of these women that is in this genealogy. Because the last time we were studying, we saw where people from the line of Shem, according to what the scripture is telling us, that is where we get the Hebrews from. And in the Old Testament, we saw several times where Shemites or Hebrew Israelite people is being identified as people from Egypt. And we did a study where we saw where ancient historian Herodotus and Tychicus, they said that the Egyptians, they were black skin and woolly hair. And we saw in Old Testament several times where different people was identified as Egyptians who were Hebrews. We saw where Moses was identified as an Egyptian. We saw where when Jacob's sons went down into Egypt, they identified their baby brother Joseph as an Egyptian. We also saw when Joseph went up to Canaan to bury his father, Egyptians and Hebrew Israelite went up to bury Jacob. And the Canaanite look at them and they identify all of them as Egyptian. So what we are saying, according to biblical texts and historical texts, people from the line of Shem and people from the line of Ham, they have more or less the same skin complexion. We come down in the New Testament and we saw where the Apostle Paul, he identified himself as a Hebrew. He was from the tribe of Benjamin. He was a Pharisee. He was circumcised. And he said he had more Hebrew blood than anybody else. And we saw where the Greek people, Roman soldiers identified Paul as an Egyptian. He said, "Aren't you not that Egyptian that went out into the desert with 400 men that was murderers?" Paul stood up and he said, "No, I am a Hebrew." So we saw from time to time where Hebrews is confused or mistakenly identified as Egyptian. So the point that I'm trying to raise here, this genealogy is mixed and it is between Hamites and Shemites. We have these four Hamites women or grandmothers that is in this genealogy. So I'm talking about, I don't understand by looking at this genealogy how we can end up having a white nation of Israel. And not only that, looking at this genealogy, because this genealogy is about the Messiah, we still end up having a white Jesus. How can you honestly, I want to take it slow. How can you honestly look at this genealogy? And that is the reason why a lot of theologians, they don't want to spend a lot of time talking about these things. They don't spend a lot of time talking about these four women and trace the genealogy way back to Genesis chapter 10. No, they don't want to do that. And I'm talking about how can we have all of this information in front of us and we still have a white Jesus. When you go and you do a study, if you take any Bible character, choose anyone you want from the Bible, and you try to find out anything about them, you can do it on your own. You will see that the picture that will come up is a European person. Every time you put in a Bible character in on the internet looking for information, you're seeing a European person coming up. Even some of our African heroes, like Hannah Bell, you ever hear about Hannah Bell? Hannah Bell, who fought a great war against the Romans, and he beat them, you know, in different times. This guy, Hannah Bell, because he was a hero, what they did, they painted him white. He's a North African. He's from Carthage in North Africa. But if you put his name in on the internet, he will come up as a white man. But he was a North African man. How about Saint Augustine? You know, one of the greatest theologians that the church had. He is from North Africa also, but you put him in, he's going to come up as a white person. And the point that I'm trying to make here is that a lot of times you hear people say, well, it doesn't matter what color Jesus was. You know, all we know that he, you know, he's our savior. And a lot of European people say, well, we know really, it doesn't matter if he's white. You know, it doesn't matter what color he is. All we know, he comes to save everybody. So why don't you just make him black? If it don't matter what, you know, what color he was, just make him the color that the scriptures say he was. But all throughout, we are seeing that all the painting that you can find of Yeshua is that he is in the complexion of a European. And what I'm saying is that racism, according to what I'm studying, racism play a big role in the interpretation of the Bible. When you look at this text and you see all of these things that we are looking at here, you can see the role that racism play in the interpretation of the Bible. And I want you to be careful not to misunderstand what I'm saying. In the interpretation of the Bible, racism play a big role. And we will get into the text. I think that's enough. Amen. So let's get into the text, and we will start from verse 6. And it said, and Jesse begot David the king. And David the king begot Solomon of her that had been the wife of Uriah. We dealt with David last week. We talked about how he took away Bathsheba from Uriah. Uriah, he was a Hittite. He was a Canaanite also. And Bathsheba, she also was a Canaanite. And we know that because her father and her grandfather is mentioned. Her grandfather, he was the chief counselor to King David. And after all of this happened, David took away Bathsheba from her husband Uriah. Ahithophel, he was very angry with David. And when Absalom rose up against his father David to overthrow him, David, a right-hand man, Ahithophel, turned against him. And he did that because of the fact that he was angry because David took advantage on his granddaughter. His granddaughter was Bathsheba. Amen. So, according to what the text tells us in Old Testament writing, Bathsheba's father, he was a Canaanite man, and also her grandfather was Canaanite descent. And it tells us in verse 6 that David the king begot Solomon of her that had been the wife of Uriah. And the scripture will tell us that the only blemish, according to scripture, that is on the record of King David is what he did in terms of taking away Bathsheba from Uriah. But we saw where he repented in Psalms 51, when he asked the Lord to have mercy upon him. He asked the Lord to wash him and to cleanse him. Wash me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Purge me, and I shall be as white as snow. He said, remove my sins and my iniquity far from me. And David, he repented of this iniquity, of this sin that he had committed against Uriah and Bathsheba. Now also, it tells us in verse 7, and Solomon begat Rehoboam. Now, we are dealing here now with King Solomon. And the Bible tells us that he was the wisest man, you know, on earth at that time. He was very rich. He was a very, very intelligent man. And he was a godly man, started out to be a godly person. But then he drifted away from the Lord, because the Bible tells us that Solomon, he loved the Lord. But then Solomon loved women. And the scripture said that he loved strange women. That is what the Bible says. And when the Bible talks about strange women, it is talking about foreign women, women who are not Hebrew Israelite. And according to what the scripture is saying, Solomon had 700 wives and 300 concubines. I don't know how he was making out. 700 wives and 300 concubines. And all of these wives and concubines, according to the scripture, they were strange women, they were foreign women. And the Bible said that they were Canaanites, they were Hittites, they were Egyptians. And most of them, their fathers were kings. And he was getting hooked up with all of these foreign ladies. And we said before that Canaanite people, people who descend from Canaanite, they are a black people. So we see where Solomon, he was hooking up with all of these women. All of these black ladies, he was hooking up with them. I know, you know, it's hard to say these things because, you know, people don't like to hear truth when it's heard. And it tells us in verse 7, and Solomon begot Rehoboam. So here we see Solomon begot Rehoboam. Rehoboam is the son of Solomon who took over kingship from King Solomon. And after the death of Solomon, Rehoboam, he took over. He was a young man. And what happened is that Solomon was very oppressive. Solomon was very oppressive to his people. And what he was doing, he was overtaxing the people. So after his death and his son took over, the people went to his son and they asked him to release the burden from their shoulder, the taxes that they were carrying, what they were paying. Release the burden. So what Solomon did, he went and he took advice from his young friends. Instead of going to the old sensible counselors that was around from the time of his father Solomon, Rehoboam did that. He didn't take counsel from the old counselors who were with his father. He took counsel from the young men, and the young men said, don't release the warden, increase it. Amen. Yes, he tightened the noose around the necks of the people. And what happened is that it caused the kingdom to be divided. Solomon was ruling over one nation of Israel. But after the death of Solomon and his son Rehoboam, he refused to release the pressure that was on the people. The kingdom was split. And we have 10 of the tribes stayed to the north, and they continue calling themselves Israel. And we have 2 that was at the south side that called themselves Judah. And it was the tribe of Judah and the tribe of Benjamin that stayed to the south. So when it talks here about Solomon begot Rehoboam, this is when the kingdom was divided and the people were taken into exile. And it tells us, and Rehoboam begot Ahijah, and Ahijah begot Asa. I'm not going to give commentary on all of them, but some of them I'm going to pick out. And when you talk here about this guy Asa, he was a very godly man. And what he did, as soon as he came into power, according to what the Bible said, this is in the Bible, you can check it out for yourself. The Bible said that he get rid of all of the Sodomites. He got rid of all the Sodomites from out of the land of Judah. And today, if you say things like that, people will, you know, come against you and say you're against homosexual and lesbian people. I think it's last week I was listening to Franklin Graham, and he was saying that the government of the world, what they're doing, they're pressuring the church to accept homosexual lifestyle and lesbian lifestyle. They want the homosexual lifestyle and the lesbian lifestyle to become a part of the church. So what the government is doing, the government of the world will be pressuring the church. And one of the tactics that they're going to use, they are going to take away the tax-exempt status from the church. Because, you know, most churches that is registered, if you're a registered charity, you don't pay taxes on your property, whatever money you take in, you are tax exempt. So what they're going to do, they're going to start to use the tax exempt status to force the church to acknowledge or to embrace homosexual people and lesbian people. We as children of God, we don't hate homosexual people. We don't hate lesbian people. But at the same time, we have to speak the truth. And we have to say that that lifestyle is not natural according to the Most High God. And it is an abomination in the sight of God. And we have to do it in love. So we see that this guy Asa, he was uncompromising. He was not a compromiser. He take that step, get rid of all of the Sodomites out of the land of Judah. And also what he did, his mother was the queen, because his father died and the queen was alive, and his mother was involved in idol worship. She had a special idol that she was worshiping. And you know what the son did? He took the idol and he broke it down and burned it and threw it in the river Kidron, or in the valley Kidron. So this man here, he was a godly man. And here the Bible tells in verse 8, and Asa begat Jehoshaphat. We know also that Jehoshaphat, he was a godly man. You remember when the enemy encamped Jehoshaphat? Jehoshaphat didn't know where to turn, and he turned to the Lord. And the Lord said, you don't have to fight. Amen. All you need to do is to stand still and behold the salvation of our God. So Jehoshaphat, he was a godly man. Jehoshaphat begat Joram, and Joram begat Uzziah. Uzziah also, he also was another godly man. And under the kingship of Uzziah, the nation of Israel, or Judah, sorry, prospered. Prosperity was taking place in Judah at the time, and he was able to fortify Judah. He built all kinds of different weapons he designed for the protection of Judah. But the Bible tells us that in all of that, his heart was lifted up. He became prideful, and you know, he feel that he was untouchable. So what happened is that he went into the temple, or into the house of God, to do sacrifice that only the priests alone supposed to go into the temple and perform sacrifice. King Zedekiah decided that he is going to go into the temple and perform sacrifice. The priests, they tried to stop him with the Levite, but he pushed his way. And as he was pushing to go into sacrifice, the Most High God allowed leprosy to come down on him. And you know what this is saying is that we can't play around with God. Amen. We can't play around with God. God is a consuming fire. Amen. And it tells us, and Uzziah, he begot Joram, and Joram begot Ahaz. Now we have Ahaz. This guy Ahaz, he was a bad dude. And this guy Ahaz, what he did, he used to encourage the people of God, people of Judah, to sacrifice their children to idol. And the people would pass their children through the fire, sacrifice them, burning their children. And he was encouraging that. And he took sacred vessels from the temple and used them to make sacrifice to different idols that was around in the time. And another thing that he did, you remember back in the Old Testament when the children of Israel was going out of Egypt towards the Promised Land, and they disobeyed the Lord, and the Lord sent fiery serpent to bite them. And Moses, he designed a snake and put it on a pole. And the people, every time they got bitten, they were able to look up on that pole and they were healed. During the time of this guy Ahaz, that serpent resurfaced, that image resurfaced, and they started to worship that serpent. And the Lord was angry with the people of Judah because of that. So he was a bad guy. And here we see Ahaz begat Hezekiah. Hezekiah was a godly man. Ahaz was one of the wickedest king in Judah. But here we see that he begot a good son. And what, you know, we are seeing here is that you don't have to go down the pathway of your parents, you know. You know, if your mom is not, you know, a godly woman, your father is a junker, your father, he might be a womanizer, You don't have to do the same thing like him. You can break away. And you can get yourself on the straight and narrow. And here we see that this guy Ahaz, he was a wicked man. But here we see he begot Hezekiah. And Hezekiah was a godly king. Amen. Praise the Lord. And Hezekiah begot Manasseh. So it kind of mixed in. Because here we see Hezekiah, Ahaz was a bad dude. And Hezekiah, his son, he was a godly man. But now we have Manasseh. Manasseh is a son of Hezekiah, the godly king. And Manasseh was a bad guy, real bad. And, you know, we are not responsible. When we train our children and they grow up to become adults, we are not responsible for their behavior. You know, I try my best to train up my three sons. I remember my father tried his best with us. I remember my father used to discipline us and he would get the big belt or the whip and he would say, Eric, you're too tall for me, kneel down. And he swing that whip or that belt over my back. I did the same thing with my boys. You know, I used to say, Kaz, Andel, Andre, whatever. Well, Andel don't get a whole lot, but he think he get the most. Andel hardly get, you know, belt over his back. But he seems to think that he get the most licks. But I don't think I probably give him a few belts, maybe a few times. But when you talk about Kaz and Andre, they really get it. And I try my best to discipline them. But I can't, I don't have, you know, the way how they turn out. When my sons then decide to, you know, live their life, ungodly life, I am not responsible for the way how they live. Because I did my best to train them up in the way of the Lord according to the scripture. And we see this right here in the Bible, that this guy Hezekiah, he was a godly man. And his son Manasseh was so ungodly. Manasseh, he was wicked, yes, thank you. And Manasseh begat Amon, and Amon begat Josiah. So it seems as though when you have one godly king, another king come after is going to be so wicked. So here we see Josiah, he was a good king. And the scripture tells us that it seems as though he was the youngest person to sit on the throne of Judah. He was 8 years old, I think, when he started to reign. So he was a good king. You see, a lot of these kings of Judah, some of them was good and some of them were bad. And in verse 11, and Josiah begat Jeconiah. So there's a kind of a bridge here in this part of the text. And if you do a closer study, you will see that this guy, Josiah here, is the Josiah that was killed by Pharaoh Necho. Pharaoh Necho came up and he was involved in a battle, you know, with King Josiah. King Josiah, I think, was a contemporary with Jeremiah. And King Josiah was in battle with Pharaoh Necho, and Pharaoh Necho killed him. And what Pharaoh Necho did, Pharaoh Necho placed King Josiah, our son, in his place, which was Jehoiakim. You hear about Jehoiakim?
Yeah.
Pharaoh Necho killed King Josiah, and then he put Jehoiakim in his room. So what we are seeing here in this verse, Jehoiakim is missing. They didn't put Jehoiakim in. And if you do a closer study, you will see that Josiah is not the father of Jeconiah. Josiah is the grandfather of Jeconiah. And Jehoiakim is the father of Jeconiah. But Jehoiakim is not in the text. Because Jehoiakim is a wicked guy. And you remember in the book of Jeremiah, Jeremiah warned Judah that the Babylonian Nebuchadnezzar is going to come and he's going to take them away into captivity. He's telling them to change their ways, and they refused to hear Jeremiah. Jeremiah was weeping. And here we see Jeremiah, the Lord instruct him to write out a scroll and go before this guy Jehoiakim. Jehoiakim sit down in his summer house in front of his fireplace, And the scribe read out the scroll to him. And every time he read a column, Jehoiakim will take that part of the scroll and he will take out his penknife that is in the text, you know, trying to destroy the word of God. Took his penknife and he will cut up the word of God and then he throw it in the fireplace. And he will say to the scribe, read again. And the scribe read and he reached to the next column and then he will take it from him, cut it up with his penknife because he don't like it. And then he threw it in his fireplace and he burned the scroll. And then the Lord said to Jeremiah, go back and write it again. Yes. Amen. Glory be to God. And because of the wickedness that this guy Jehoiakim did, the Lord pronounced a blood curse on him. And the Lord said, the Most High God said that nobody from his line is going to sit on the throne of David. So here we see that this person here, in verse 11, when he said Josiah begat Jehoiakim, Jeconiah is the son of Jehoiakim. He is the grandson of Josiah. And a blood curse is pronounced on Jehoiakim. And Jeconiah is his son. And here we see Jeconiah is in the ancestry of the Messiah. And the Most High God already said that he can't, nobody from his line is going to sit on the throne of David. So there's a great problem here. Amen. And the Most High God have to create a bridge so that we can get over this chasm that is being created here. Because the Most High God pronounced a blood curse on Jehoiakim and all of his generation. And we will deal with this a little bit later. And his brothers, about the time they were carried away to Babylon. So this is the time that the exile is taking place. Jeconiah or Jehoiakim, he refused to listen to Jeremiah. And Jehoiakim was taken in chain into Babylon by the Babylonians. And what they did, they took this Jeconiah and they installed him as king. And he reigned as king for a short time. And then he also was taken into captivity into Babylon. I think his father, is either he died on his way to Babylon or he died during the time when Nebuchadnezzar came in and invaded. So it tells us that was about the time that they were carried away into Babylon. This was the time that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and Daniel, and all of these people were taken into captivity during that time. Now it tells us in verse 12, and after they were brought to Babylon, Jeconiah, this is the same guy, you know, his line, there's a blood curse that is upon his line, and the Most High God said that nobody from his line, from his father's line, will be able to sit on the throne of David, but he is in the lineage of David. Jeconiah begat Shealtiel, and Shealtiel begat Zerubbabel. This is when they were in captivity in Babylon. These two guys here, Shealtiel and Zerubbabel, these are the guys that lead the exile from Babylon back to Jerusalem, back to the land of Israel, to rebuild the wall, to rebuild the temple and all of that. These two guys were very instrumental in bringing the people back to the land. And according to what the Bible tells us, I think it was only about 50,000 people that returned. There was a lot of people in Babylon, but they were doing well. And when the invitation was given for them to go back to their homeland, they said, no, we're not going because we're doing too good. It's like all of us here, we settled in Canada here, and we don't even want to see St. Vincent. We don't even want to see Grenada. We don't want to see, like some people say, well, if I see St. Vincent, a piece of bread, I'm not going to eat it. They don't even want to see the country that they're from. You know, because they become so prosperous that That same thing happened to the exile when they went into Babylon. They got the opportunity to go back to Jerusalem, but they decided they're not going to go back because they were doing well in Babylon at the time. Now it tells us, and Zerubbabel in verse 13, he begot Abihu, and Abihu begot Eliakim, and Eliakim begot Azor. So apparently these guys, they were born after the exile return back to the land. They were born in Canaan or in Israel. They wasn't born in captivity. You know, the captivity is over. And it was 14, and Azor begot Zadok, and Zadok begot Akim, and Akim begot Eliu. So all these guys, you know, there's not a whole lot I, you know, discover on these guys, but you know, they were not, I guess they were not so important, but the Most High God still see it fit to put them in the genealogy of Yeshua. And Elihu begot Eliezer, and Eliezer begot Matan, and Matan begot Jacob. Now we are getting down to where we are going to talk again about this guy, Jeconiah. And Jacob begot Joseph, the husband of Mary. You see, Jacob, he begot Joseph. Now, right here, there is a bridge in verse 16. You know, if it's supposed to say Joseph begot somebody, but it didn't say Joseph begot anybody. All it said here is that Joseph is the husband of Mary. So what the Holy Spirit is doing here, the Holy Spirit is showing us where the Most High God, he make a bridge. Yes, he make a bridge. He divinely intervened. And this is why we have what we know as the virgin birth. Because as we said that this guy, Jeconiah, because of what his father did, his father was so wicked, the Most High God pronounced a blood curse upon him. So if, because of the fact that Jeconiah and Jehoiakim, they are part of this bloodline, and a curse is already pronounced upon them, the Most High God came up with a plan whereby he is going to get the Messiah to be able to become king and still, you know, be in the bloodline, but he will not be contaminated with the curse that was pronounced upon Jehoiakim and Jeconiah. So what happened here? He tells us in verse 16, and Jacob begot Joseph, the husband of Mary. Now what the text is showing us here is that Joseph was not the biological father of Yeshua. Joseph was the legal father of Yeshua. But according to what the text is telling us, Joseph, he was the husband of Mary, of whom was born Yeshua, who is called the Messiah. So as we know it, this is how the virgin birth came in, because of the fact that there was a blood curse pronounced on Jeconiah and his bloodline. People from his bloodline could not sit upon the throne of David. So because of that, the Most High God had to come up with a different way to get around that. And the way that the Most High God came up with is that he planned, in his sovereign plan, he had what we know as the virgin birth of the Messiah. We are going to stay there and we are going to pick up next time. May the Lord bless us. I'm going to ask the musicians to come back and we will sing a song. Waymaker, bless the Lord. Anybody have any prayer requests that you'd like to deal with at the end of the song, you can come forward. We'll sing this song as we close up for today. And we'll pick up there another time as we continue to deal with the genealogy of the Messiah, Yeshua. Bless the Lord.